This is an important election, my friends, and I'm determined to win it. Canadians want change.
Hey, everyone!
Sunny ways, my friends, sunny ways.
I take it very seriously that they chose to vote for me.
Because it's 2015.
From Toronto's historic distillery district, a conversation with the Prime Minister. Here is Lisa Laflamme.
Justin Trudeau has been in office for less than 2 months and his popularity is still soaring.
Justin! Hey!
The Prime Minister who's like a magnet for the public. It is Trudeau-mania 2015. Walking to our conversation, the crowds just wanted to see him, get close to him, and of course, get selfies.
I can see wherever you go, there's a mob scene that follows you.
There's a level of interest and engagement in what we're doing, I guess.
I think it's really how you react with people. I mean, you bring them all in, and then people want that, you know?
But the other way around.
People are thinking, this guy's got great policies. I think they're saying, this is a cool young prime minister.
It would really surprise me if they didn't think, okay, you know what? The right kinds of things are being done in a way that we like.
Thank you so much, and thank you for all the hope.
That woman who just said to you, thank you for the hope. Wow, I can just imagine the responsibility attached to...
See, but I say that to Canadians all the time, whether I say it explicitly or implicitly to myself. People are coming at me with extremely high expectations, but with a positive hopefulness that, quite frankly, I think is going to be essential to getting the country to where we need to be.
There we go. That was it.
Now you've almost become an international celebrity. And I wonder what kind of responsibility that is for you. And when you look at the way the world, not just Canadians, but the world is responding to you.
There are lots of things that Canada has and does that we don't celebrate enough, that the world should be hearing about. And if, since the election, the world has been noticing a little more of those kinds of things, the openness to welcoming, the balance approach on a broad range of things, then that's a good thing. And I take this as a way of showcasing Canada and Canadians.
Has that been overwhelming?
I've regularly gone through moments in my life where people have gotten overly interested in the personal or the trappings around my life, whether it was growing up son of or more recently in politics. And I've learned very, very well to accept it as the nice compliment that it is in many cases, but put it aside because ultimately it doesn't determine what we do, what I do, and it doesn't really affect me all that much other than to be reminded that, yeah, I've got to do a good job because there's a lot of people watching, but that's just par for the course.
But when it's, you know, selfies with kids or putting a kid's winter boot on, sitting with a kid on Parliament Hill, handshaking with world leaders, do you feel that you're always on?
No more than when I was a high school teacher having to be on for the class of 30 kids that I taught. No more than I've been aware that I was my father's son all my life, and therefore people would come to me with a certain awareness or attention. And yes, it gets a little more elaborate or complicated these days with people and attention and selfies. But the fundamental truth of connecting with someone, of actually paying attention to them, of meeting them, of getting to know in a short conversation, you know, hi, how you doing, what are you worried about, how are you feeling today, what's your hopes for the future?
Some people feel that it almost seems like you're still campaigning.
It's easy in our modern democracies to sort of feel, oh, we'll check in every 4 years with a passing grade or, you know, change the regime, but what we have now is a much more engaged, active citizenship. And for me, to stay connecting with people, hearing from them, this is working, this is not, that ongoing feedback does actually help me and us govern better.
Some things don't feel like governing. For example, the Vogue photo shoot. Give me the backstory on how that came about.
As you know, I'm always looking at reaching out to people in a variety of ways, and we know that not everyone, you know, peers at the, you know, political pages attentively in their newspapers. And engaging in a broad range of publications is something that I've always done. I'm a little surprised at how offended some people are, but it's a fashion magazine. I mean, no, there are lots of ways and lots of different engagements on talking about politics, talking about the kind of world you want to build and create.
I think what people were saying was how intimate the photos were, and it made some Canadians feel uncomfortable or wonder, was that appropriate for that kind of intimacy for the Prime Minister and his wife?
It's a picture of me holding my wife. For me, I mean, you can see moments like that anytime you see Sophie and I having dinner together or walking down the street. I don't think anyone would be surprised to see that I love my wife very much, and I'm holding her.
So I have to ask, on behalf of women in this country, who picked Sophie's dress?
Sophie did.
Did she?
Up with a range of options that they wanted for Vogue, and she picked the one that she thought was nice.
Oscar de la Renta.
Indeed.
There were even some Canadians who said it should have been a Canadian designer.
You know what? She's doing a pretty good job of highlighting some great Canadian designers as well. I think the sense was, you know, we'll let the Vogue people, pick what's good for them.
One of the things about all of this outreach has been what I think was a remarkable image, to see the Prime Minister basically in the middle of the night at Pearson International Airport welcoming the refugees.
Thank you. Welcome home. Thank you.
Why was that so important for you to be there that night?
You know, it's been, as you said, a busy couple of months for us. We've done an awful lot of things in the first months that actually really matter. But when I was standing there watching that first family come towards me, I sort of realized, wow, we did this. Canadians asked me to do this, and I did this. This was concrete. And yes, all the things that we're doing are going to have a positive impact in people's lives. But that one right there was the first really tangible big one. This family coming towards me, who wouldn't have been walking towards me at that time if the election, or coming to Canada if the election had gone differently, were there because of incredible hard work that we did and because of what Canadians wanted us to do.
Was there one really difficult conversation that night with one family or one person, or memorable?
The most memorable part of it for me was actually seeing how I felt about this, how excited I was, how much I felt that this was something that was really important to me, seeing that reflected in every single person, worker, volunteer there at Pearson. I mean, I had a chance to chat with them beforehand, and they were all as excited as I was about welcoming these families to Canada. And that, for me, was unbelievable.
The refugee resettlement policy has changed. I mean, you sat across from me after the election and said 25,000 people here before New Year's Day. Obviously, that's changed. What was the moment where you said, this is not tenable?
Well, I mean, it's changed in that 25,000 now by the end of February. So it's a little longer. The convincing element to me was after the Paris attacks, I realized that there was an increase in fear. Anxiety and public perception could mean that these families might have been obviously welcomed, but also a little bit feared. And I didn't want that. We wanted to remove that entirely. And if all it took was, you know, taking a few more weeks and being able to reassure Canadians that way, then this is something that isn't about 1 month, or give or take.
You're suggesting then you have no concerns of the thousands of refugees coming into this country to ease the mind of concerned Canadians?
I am tremendously confident in our intelligence agencies and our border services agencies, in the work that the various groups, including the UN, are doing to ensure that Canadians are safe. Refugees coming to Canada are fleeing terrorism, not bringing terrorism.
Your immigration minister used the number 50,000, and I wonder what the ceiling is for potential refugees coming in. Germany, by the way, has just hit its 1 millionth.
I think doing more is important, and certainly 25,000 as a kickstart to the whole system was necessary. But ongoing, Canada needs to do more, and a lot of how we do will depend on how successful we are at integrating this first wave, what we're able to continue to do, because obviously there's 60 million refugees around the world right now.
Do you have a benchmark in your head, though, of a number?
Not really. I'm very much focused on doing what we can in the right way. Canada wants to both be part of the solution, but also showcase how more countries can do more, particularly our neighbors to the south. And that means making sure that we look at these families as an investment in our future, because we know that 5 years, 10 years, 30 years from now, this will be a story of Canada like the Ismailis, like the Vietnamese, like so many people who fled terrible situations and have contributed so much to Canada.
As you say, the tone in Canada is so dramatically different to what's happening in the United States. That's largely because of the comments by Donald Trump and the oxygen he has taken up on this anti-Muslim stance. How much damage do you think he's done to the overall dialogue?
I like to try and take a longer view of this. I mean, there's no certainty that he's going to end up the Republican nominee, let alone the president. But sometimes it takes voices like that to shake everyone back to sort of some semblance of perspective and reality. I mean, you cannot pretend to be a free and open country and say that you're going to discriminate against people based on their religion. You just can't do that. So I think Americans are starting to ask themselves questions about what kind of country they are and who they want to be. And it's obviously an election year, and I'm not going to weigh in more than that. But I will highlight that there have been recent moments in Canadian political history, whether it was a Charte des Valeurs in Quebec or the snitch line that the previous government put forward, or even some of the things that the former mayor of Toronto said a few times that made people sort of wonder, okay, now what is popular, what is responsible, how can you get attention and maybe get votes? And I'm sort of deeply reassured by the outcome of all those different moments where we saw Canadians fundamentally chose not to discriminate against people because of fear and the politics of division. And I have high hopes for the Americans as well.
You know, it's funny, you don't want to say anything more because there's a campaign going on, but even David Cameron has come out and named names on Donald Trump. And aren't there times in history that you shelve compliance and appeasement and you call someone out?
Oh, absolutely. And I think it's been extremely powerful to be able to contrast Canada's response to the Syrian refugee crisis with Donald Trump's response to the Syrian refugee crisis and allow people to draw their own conclusions. I don't think anybody in Canada or around the world thinks that I have anything supportive to say or anything but condemnation for Donald Trump.
A conversation with the Prime Minister continues.
In two short months, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau has changed Canada's conversation on global issues, including the controversial plan to pull our fighter jets from the Allied air war against ISIS.
Your relationship with Barack Obama seems very solid, except for the decision to pull out of the air war. Twice now he's stood up, addressed his nation. Twice now he has not mentioned Canada. Do you see that as a rebuke to your decision to pull the CF-18s out?
No, I mean, I had a conversation with him the day after I got elected, in which I highlighted that, and he said he understood that I made commitments, where I reassured him that we will continue to be a strong member of the coalition, including engaging militarily. We're just shifting our approach to look at how we can be more helpful, and that's a process that we're engaged in with him, with all of our allies, to ensure that there is a continued strong support for this coalition by Canada.
Does it concern you, though, that he keeps, he keeps forgetting Canada when he addresses his thanks to the allies and names countries?
No, it doesn't concern me at all, because there are a lot of issues that we've talked about. And what we're highlighting is there's a huge range of things. And even though, no, we're not continuing in the airstrikes with the six CF-18s, we are going to continue in other ways to make a meaningful difference.
Let's talk about some of those other ways. What are some of the things, if you can tell us now, that we will be doing? The refueling jets, for example, and surveillance. Is that a yes or a no?
It's likely that we'll keep those in, but we're in discussions. Our Minister of Defense is thoroughly engaged in this, looking at how we can be supportive in concrete ways that will make a difference and help our allies and help in the fight against ISIL in very, very solid ways. But there also needs to be smart humanitarian and refugee elements folded into that. There also have to be governance and diplomatic engagements. Obviously, the situation in Syria with Russia and Turkey and all the coalition, how we're engaging in that, there need to be passed through to stability.
You say that Obama is fine with your decision to pull out of the air war. Does he know something we don't know on what our contribution will be?
He has simply said, as you announce that you are pulling out the jets, make sure that you're announcing how you're going to be stepping up, so there isn't a propaganda win for ISIL, so people understand that Canada continues to be a strong player in the coalition. And that's what I've been saying from the very beginning with him and to everyone, that Canada continues to be committed, including militarily, to the fight against ISIL, because we need to stop these guys.
Let's talk about the possible outcomes for the Syrian civil war. And in your view, it was there before ISIS was there. So do you think regime change is the answer here?
I think regime change is inevitable. Is it the first step towards ending the Syrian civil war? Probably not. But can we get to a responsible transition for a Syria without Bashar al-Assad? Absolutely.
So he's got to go.
Yes, he has to go in a responsible way.
So it's been 5 years now. What is a responsible way?
Listen, with Russia engaged the way it is right now, there are greater possibilities of moving towards that, and that's what many of the negotiations the international community is weighing in on. People know that this cannot continue.
Russia has certainly complicated this, and I wonder if during the G20 you had an opportunity at all to speak with Vladimir Putin.
I took a moment to go over and said that you might have noticed that we have changed, Canada has changed its approach on a broad range of issues. You said, yes, I have noticed. I said, but you have to know that in regards to Ukraine, we stand firmly against Russian interference, and we stand with the people of Ukraine, and we need you to move forward in implementing the Minsk Peace Accords. And that there is room for Russia to play a more positive role in all sorts of places than it has in the past, but it has to come to terms with where it has been aggressively unhelpful in many situations, and where the international community is not likely to see it as a positive force for stability and good, not at this point.
A conversation with the Prime Minister.
What do you think when you're wandering around without a coat on in December?
I think we're getting a broader range and variation of weather. Tying too closely weather to climate is always worrisome, but there's no question that there are more irregular events. I mean, we could be under 8 feet of snow, and that might be a result of climate change as well. So you
don't attach anything to this mild December day?
I won't call it global warming, but I will say that this is an example of the unpredictable weather patterns that we're now facing.
but from Trudeau's government quick action on climate change.
It's accepted.
Signing on to a global agreement to cut greenhouse gas emissions.
You've endorsed this goal to lower the global temperature. Such an ambitious target. How is this going to be enforced?
Having had an agreement at which all the countries of the world came together and recognized that this is a massive problem and a massive priority, but also an opportunity. An opportunity to think differently, how we create strong economies that are in sync with the natural world, that are resilient to the changes that are going to come through climate change. This is a very, very clear statement that we are all in this together. And here at home, we're going to sit down with the provinces and engage with all the different things that we can do, not just to reduce our emissions, which obviously we have to, but to get towards a lower carbon economy through innovation, through research, through entrepreneurship, through green solutions, clean energy. Because if we're going to move ourselves off of fossil fuels in the coming decades, we have to have something to replace it with.
That's the big question. What does it do to the oil sector in this country?
Well, I think, and we see the big oil sands companies are already heavily investing in renewables and looking for diversification at the same time as they're being very innovative around reducing their emissions, around being more and more mindful of the impact on the environment. It's the trend we have to go in. We have to make sure that we're supporting that transition and enforcing it at the same time. And getting that balance right is going to be easier because everyone, all 10 premiers, all 13 premiers, and I are on the same page that we have to reduce this. And even I know you're going to say Brad Wall, even he is very strong about the CCS technology that Alberta carbon capture and sequestration technology that they've been pushing on. And he wants to see it done in a market way, and he's talking about partnering with Quebec on some of the things that they're doing as well.
Brad Wall also says, as a province that is a greater emitter than others, they're going to need more money.
Well, that's where we sit down.
But at this point, what in your mind, you must have thought about this for a great deal of time.
Yes, and we also have to remember that there is a big picture that we need to be positively playing in, because quite frankly, the atmosphere doesn't care where carbon gets emitted, and that's where we have to be smart about this globally. Moving forward, we're going to be able to both create jobs and get our resources to market in an environmentally responsible way.
So all of these things we talk about all cost money. The deficit, we now understand, is going up. I think during the campaign it was $10 billion was the deficit. Canadians thought that was the ceiling, and now it looks like it might be the floor.
What we put together as a platform, as a plan for Canada, was an economic plan that recognized that for 10 years we've had the lowest growth record of any government since R.B. Bennett in the 30s following the Great Depression. That Canada needs growth that works for everyone, not just the top 1% or the top 0.1 of 1%, but everyone. And that means putting more money in the pockets of the middle class and those working hard to join it. But it also means investing in the infrastructure that our communities need.
Obviously, Canadians supported that. They elected you. But my question is, how big does it get, the deficit?
Well, we've put forward two anchor points. One is that we need to return to balance by the end of our first mandate in 2019. And second, that we keep our debt to GDP ratio decreasing.
Economists say you can do that. You can keep your debt to GDP ratio going down while the deficit could balloon as high as $25 billion.
But what we're not looking at in terms of, one of the things that we talked about a lot during the election campaign is these fiscal discipline and fiscal responsibility means investing in the right kinds of things that are going to lead to growth and not create debt on the backs of future generations. Building better public transit means better opportunities for future generations over the next 10, 20 years. Investing in resilient, greener infrastructure means better economic opportunities for future generations, not debt. Investing in proper social housing or better childcare, these mean investing in future generations. So that's the lens we're looking at it primarily at.
Through the campaign, you also introduced, you know, the middle income tax break. Now we see that the math was off, you know, this big gap. How did that happen?
We assumed a higher level of inelasticity than some of the current thinkers do. We'll see how it plays out, but the fact is we made a commitment to lower taxes on the middle class and to raise them on the wealthiest 1% and have them, you know, happen at the same time to make sure that we were not just redistributing income, but putting money in the pockets of people who were going to be spending it and creating economic activity and supporting small businesses. And we think we found the right balance.
Well, you found a balance that leaves a $1.2 billion gap.
But what we're doing is we're lowering taxes for the middle class. You're saying we shouldn't lower taxes for the middle
class? No, I'm saying where do you get that money?
No, this is the question that we've always been asking, and we've said we're willing to invest in our future.
Coming up, conversation with the Prime Minister.
You look around and you see, you know, the sky rises, you see infrastructure. Do you now look at things and say, oh God, there's going to be, that's got to be fixed, and we've got to think about all of these things on where we're going to divvy up that?
No, I don't. And the reason why is because it's not up to me as Prime Minister. That's for locals. That's for the municipal governments. It's for the province to weigh in. But it's not up to the federal government, certainly not the Prime Minister, to decide, oh, you know what, we really should do this or we really should do that.
Do you think it's bigger than you even thought before? Everyone's coming out of the woodwork saying, look, we've got to fix this, we've got to fix that.
Well, I mean, we knew that for not just for the past 10 years, but for longer than that, you know, Canadians have been neglecting our infrastructure, and there's an awful lot of work to do. You know, we're seeing the extra challenging numbers and a sluggish recovery and oil prices staying stubbornly low, and yes, there's concern
for that.
You
just hit them all. That's like the trifecta of bad news.
For sure. But what that doesn't change the fact that we need to invest. It makes it even more important.
How are you going to find a mechanism to make sure that the money goes to the right hands?
Well, that's what I've always said to the premiers, to the municipal leaders. Look, Canada, the federal government wants to be a partner. All we're going to ask is that you show us that this is going to be good for your community, good for the long-term growth of your economy, and not just good to cut a ribbon for your re-election. And that's where we're going to be very, very rigorous about the results. And it's very tempting for politicians to stand up and announce a $20 million program for this, for that, cut a ribbon, make all sorts of great announcements. And then 2 years later, 3 years later, someone says, well, how did that go? Oh, we don't know. We got a good boost out of the polls and that announcement, and that's how that went. Well, no. Did it actually achieve the jobs, the help for the people who needed it? What are the metrics? How are you measuring the results of the investments that you're making in the name of Canadians? And that's one of the things that we're very much trying to shift government towards, to be able to measure in concrete ways, you know, what impact we're having with hard-earned tax dollars.
I know that you have electoral reform goals. You campaigned on them. You said that was the last first-past-the-post election Canadians would have. So at this juncture, I'm interested in knowing what the model is you look to.
I think there's a lot of different countries that are doing different things, but there is no country out there that looks exactly like Canada. We have an extraordinary geographically diverse country with disparate, very distinct regions. I'm very much keen on making sure that people can feel that their votes are valued, that they had a direct impact on being heard and being listened to, regardless of what riding they're in. And moving forward, we're going to be consulting with Canadians, we're going to be talking with the opposition parties, but I'm really hoping that we're going to be able to engage Canadians in a higher level conversation that comes to, well, what kind of country do we want? What kind of governance do we want? Do we want a more partisan governance? Do we want a less partisan governance? Do we need to augment minority voices, or do we need to pull together people in common themes? Different countries will have different answers. Different Canadians might have different answers on that. And that's why I'm really, as a student of politics and as someone fascinated by it, looking forward to this engagement process where Canadians get to really design what kind of future electoral system matters to them.
But how do you protect against a system that may in fact favor your own party for decades to come?
You trust that Canadians are going to be able to set out very clear rules, very clear expectations from what it is that they want out of their elected officials.
Maybe referendum is the answer.
Listen, that's certainly something that a number of people are talking about, although I will highlight the fact that the Conservatives are the ones talking about the need to have a referendum, need to consult Canadians, when for the first time ever they put forward an electoral reform bill, the so-called Fair Elections Act, with no consultation of Canadians, no cooperation or support from the opposition parties. They basically rammed it through and tried to stack the deck in their own favor. Didn't work out that way, and we're going to be able to undo a lot of those things. Should we have a referendum on that? Should we have a referendum on everything that matters to the future of the country? You have to make choices at one point, and we are committed to holding full, engaged consultations, and we'll see where that takes us.
You have such an ambitious agenda, and you're going to need the Senate to push this through. So let's talk a little bit about that. The new plan, as I understand, still is the Prime Minister who will be choosing who the ultimate senators will
be.
Okay.
Yes. And that's the only alternative to that is constitutional negotiations with the provinces. Now, nobody wants to reopen the Constitution, or very few people want that. So what we're going to try and do is bring a level of nonpartisanship to propose a number of good names for the Senate.
Is that possible? And a nonpartisan group? You're
sure
confident?
Absolutely. I mean, Canadians have shown that there is a desire to see good people in office of all different parties. The name that's put forward, the Prime Minister should be able to say, I'm appointing this person, and people should be able to say, yep, that's a good person for the Senate.
On appointments, before Christmas, you asked 33 people to basically hand in their badge to step aside, people who'd been appointed by Harper. To this point, has anybody taken you up on that?
I haven't been engaged directly on the responses in that. I mean, this is something that, if we got elected, promising a renewed appointments process with less partisanship, less sort of sneaking around, good people in good places. And quite frankly, Canadians told me and told all of us just how sick and tired they were of the aggressive partisanship, of the tone, of the cronyism that, you know, resulted in Mike Duffy and Pamela Wallin and others. And people saw that through appointments. So the fact that when we came into office, we suddenly discovered that the Prime Minister had made appointments, some of them 2 years away from now, in order to keep certain people in place over the long period, it just really, it really bothers me, because it's not, I mean,
are they not qualified?
And there's a range of folks in there. There's great people in that list. But the process, that's why we've said, look, the process just really looks ugly, and it could, you know, backfire on you and your ability to do your job as well. Let's do a proper process, because Mr. Harper, played fast and loose with principles of Parliament on this.
Your own father, though, made patronage appointments before John Turner took over.
Yeah, and John lost the election partially because of it. Certainly lost the debate because of it. There are things done in the past, including by my father, that I disagree with. And what we're definitely trying to do is create a better way moving forward, and I certainly feel that appealing to people who received those appointments to reflect on the way they were appointed and maybe accept that stepping down voluntarily might be in keeping with what Canadians would like to see as a style of service, well, we'll see.
A conversation with the Prime Minister from Toronto's historic distillery district.
October 19th ushered in not only change for this country, but certainly an enormous upheaval for your own family. And I wonder what was, if there is, one sort of key reality check for your family since October 19th?
The heightened degree of RCMP protection is now sort of the reality. You know, Sophie's like, oh, let's just go for a walk in the park, or let's, you know, just go down the street and see our friends. I'm like, okay, just let's give the RCMP 10 minutes to get the motorcade in place. And she's like, oh yeah, I forgot that. I mean, the worry is always, and I'll have to be very aware of this in the coming years, that level of protection and motorcade-ness can leave you disconnected from the community that you're serving. For me, at first anyway, I'm keeping it as a reminder of how important it is that I am worthy in my service to Canadians.
What about the service as a dad? How challenging is that to be spending time with your kids?
Actually, I mean, and this will change as well, but during the 80-day election campaign, I was 6 days across the country and then one day with my kids, and then 6 days across the country. And that went on for whatever it was, 11 weeks. Since the election's been over, I've been home with my kids almost every single night. Yes, late nights, yes, lots of work to do, but I've been able to come home for dinner and then go back to work. Or, I mean, there is an anchoredness in Ottawa that I think my kids are appreciating, and certainly I know Sophie is.
I bet. I mean, it was such a change seeing your family on a foreign trip with the Queen and in France. How challenging is it to find the right balance in showcasing your family and keeping them out of the spotlight? How do you know when is the right time?
Well, I have a pretty good example in my own parents who understood that if my dad didn't bring us with him on his trip sometime, we wouldn't get to see him all that much. So bringing my kids with me to an event is about spending a little time with them and them also tangibly seeing what it is that I do as a job. And on the other hand, it's also about realizing that there are extraordinary opportunities to see the world, to engage, to learn about the responsibility that a prime minister has and that one has to serve. So getting that balance right helps me do my job, helps me focus on what matters.
You actually, though, took a bit of flack, and I think probably as a result of seeing the nannies in France, people said, hey, this is the guy who during the campaign said, I don't need taxpayer money to pay for my kids' care. How did you get that so wrong?
Oh, I don't think a question of getting it wrong. We show up in the Prime Minister's residence, and there's a staff of 6-7 people, and you can imagine that the needs that Mr. Harper had with his wife and two, older teenage children was very different than the needs we have with a baby and two young kids.
I don't think anyone disputes that. It was the whole.
We're keeping the same budget that is allocated to the Prime Minister's staff, and that's it's staying stable.
Were you surprised at the reaction?
No, there are always people gonna, try and find things to pick and tug and poke at. I have a tremendous amount of confidence in Canadians' ability to understand what is done responsibly and what is not.
And on your family, I mean, I know this is a personal question, but I'm curious because Hadrian certainly stole the show at the swearing in. And in France, he's now almost two. Is your family complete, or could it possibly be expanded?
One of the conversations I've had with Sophie every now and then is, well, if she could be sure it was a girl, we might look at number four. We're sort of ongoing discussion around that. We're not fully decided, but we're certainly happy with what we have now, and that we'll just see what happens.
One of the questions will be, when you eventually move into 24 Sussex, have you been able to go through it and see where your future home will be? And what's the timeline?
We've taken the whole question, 24 Sussex, and we've given it over to the NCC and to sort of independent folks to make recommendations on what can be done and what needs to be done around that. I mean, this is not my house. It's the house, it's going to be the house for prime ministers for the next 50, 100 years as well.
Will you have a say in cupboards and countertops?
Probably have a say in paint color or something like
faucets, that. Faucets, that's a biggie too in your rent. It's not exactly a normal Canadian renovation, you must admit.
But at the same time, I certainly know that I'll be focused on things a lot more important than faucets at 24 Sussex.
A conversation with the Prime Minister.
I work for Bill Street. Can you come and have a beer?
I would like to, but I'm working right now.
All right, well, you come by and see us later.
Yes, everybody wants a piece of you. You know that?
Well, you know what? I think there is a sense that we are pulling together to do something great. And people talk about the high expectations on me. Sure, there are. But I have really high expectations of Canadians. And over the past couple of months, people have been stepping up saying, thanks for making space for me. Thanks for moving us in the right direction. I know we have a lot of work to do, but we're going to get it done.
Managing those expectations, though, must be overwhelming. Do you at some point say, look, we're going to have to back off some of our promises because the need is so overwhelming?
Well, it's not about backing off. You know, we have 4 years to get a lot done. It doesn't all have to happen in the first 6 months.
As we move into the new year, I want to get your thoughts on, you know, the enormous instability that exists out there for Canadians, even fear, given the events of 2015. So how do you manage the expectations as we move into this new year?
I think one of the things that I drew from the election is that Canadians are basically optimistic about the coming years. I mean, they're hopeful for the future. We'll see what challenges we have, how we're able to convert those challenges into opportunity.
So domestically for the new year, what's top things on your priority list?
Top thing is getting the Canada Child Benefit done in the budget, so we can hopefully bring it in for July 1st. That's a more generous child benefit for the families who need it by not giving those benefits to the wealthiest families.
What about Bill C-51? We didn't hear much of that at all in the throne speech. So what's the...
We talked about what Canadians expect, which is to make sure that we're keeping people safe and defending our rights and freedoms. People know you have to have both. We have to be safe and we have to be free. And getting those both together is really important.
And you've made such a commitment of reestablishing, if you will, the relationship, improving the relationship with First Nations.
First Nations can look to having a true partner in the federal government in a nation-to-nation sense, making sure that First Nations and Métis Nation, Inuit peoples, are able to fully participate and be optimistic about the future of their economies, of their communities, of their country.
And internationally, this is also a huge year of change coming up in the United States. What things do you want to accomplish with Barack Obama before he leaves the White House?
Well, I think there's a nice sort of confluence. In my first year, I'm going to want to get a whole bunch of important things done, and he's looking at what he can get done as his legacy in his last year. And both of us acting together to make sure that there's greater prosperity, opportunity, security, freedom for people in North America, and engaging more with Mexico as well is going to be really important for us.
Before we close, I'd love to get, if there is one, your favorite moment from 2015.
Probably that moment where I stood there waiting with a winter coat in my hands as a Syrian family was coming to Canada, walking through the airport terminal with me. That was a tangible, concrete, life-changing for them expression of what Canadians can do if we pull together and decide that we're better than people think we are.
It'll be a very happy new year for the refugees, and we wish you a happy new year. Thank you so much.
Always a pleasure, Lisa.